I'm glad you're here. How was Thanksgiving?
Oh, great. I mean, it was something. In fact, it's such a time when everybody tunes in, because this time it was COVID-19 time, so everyone was online. And so what happened at home was that the internet was giving me a trouble. So I traveled right now 60 miles to the home of my nephew, Biju, so that I could get online and make sure that the internet was okay. So here I am.
I'm kind of praising the Lord for that, because if you go down, I've got at least 50 minutes to fill in, and that would be very difficult. Tell me, does an Indian doctor living in the United States celebrate Thanksgiving?
Yes. Once you get to another country, then, well, you do as when in Rome, do as the Romans do. So you understand what it means. And it's a tremendous place and time of getting together, of really being thankful. So it can't be confined to actually one country or one idea. The idea of thanks is always there. So it's a great time to be with family and to lift your heart in grateful thanks.
Americans actually will say that Thanksgiving is the best holiday of all.
That's true.
Can you tell me just very briefly, because Dr. Pandit and I, we've got some, he sent me some questions, I got some things. I'm going to stay within the spirit of the questions you sent, but I want to give us as much time as possible today to really get into this, because this is our last time with you this year. And I was saying to our congregation, I hope we can get you back next year. But could you just tell me very briefly, for us Aussies, most of us haven't got a clue, what is Thanksgiving and what's it for?
Thanksgiving is actually a remembrance of the time when the early pilgrims had come to the country. It was a harsh winter. They were struggling because they didn't know how the land, they did not know how to survive. And it was a time when the Native Americans came to their side, taught them how to survive the winter. And at that time, they formed a bond, as it were. And in that bond, they both survived. And especially the pilgrims who were new to the country. It was especially the horrible winters that are there in the northern parts of America, with snow and hardly any food.
If only that boat had landed a bit further south in Florida.
That's right. But that's the point when that time when they really realized that their life had depended on the friendship of the Native Americans, who gave them the friendship, taught them how to live and survive, and that's how we have the great America today. And so, in remembrance of that, in grateful thanks to that, not only to the Native Americans, but to the God whom they worshipped, they began this great tradition of thanksgiving.
And it is actually to God, isn't it? Primarily it's a thanksgiving to God for his goodness for this great nation that God built. And it is a great nation. It's struggling at the moment, but it is a great nation. Let's get straight into some questions. I promise you, Dr. Pandit, we're staying within the breadth of what you and I have discussed. But can I show you, this is a little bit of revision, but it'll launch us in where we want to go today. Can I show you a short video and then get you to comment on it?
Sure.
Thank you, Hunty. Were you able to hear that, Doctor?
Stephen Fry, I have written a little bit about him, and I'm going to just show you this book, if you can see it. It says, Setting the Record Straight. I have written it out on atheism, agnosticism, and evolution. And the first, this book is about video clips on the internet. And the first one is Stephen Fry, exactly this discussion. I have analyzed some of his statements in this book. So let me just answer at least one or two of the things that he mentioned. He mentioned quite
a few. Thank you.
Number one, he says, if you throw God away, we will have a pure life. How much purer has it been today? What has happened if you throw him off? Where did all those, he talked about some worms eating the eyes. Has the worm stopped eating the eyes when he threw God off? No, it's still the same, exactly there. In fact, he echoes what Bertrand Russell had said many, many years ago, the British philosopher, the atheistic, staunch, hard-nosed atheistic philosopher, who said, if you ever go into a pediatric ward, you will come away definitely denouncing God and saying he does not exist at all. Now, it appears really a good argument, except when you think about it, it is not an intellectual argument. It is an emotional argument. It is appealing to your emotions. It is saying, look how horrible it is, and therefore we don't want it. But that is not the way to have an intellectual argument. An intellectual argument takes the point and looks at it. So here's how I would answer either Bertrand Russell or Stephen Fry. I'd say, why don't you come with me to that pediatric ward? You are asking me to look at the children who are suffering and saying they are suffering needlessly, and therefore you are willing to throw off God. Let me show you the parents. You are not the parent of that child. I will show you parents of those children who are suffering, who will die maybe in the next few hours, the next few days or months, and ask some of them, and they will tell you how staunchly they still believe in a loving God. How can you answer that? Answer that as well. Don't just answer what you feel like when you look at something that is bad. Answer, how can somebody look and experience that as parents and still hold on to the idea that there is a loving God? Now, if that happens, you cannot run away from that either. So when you ask them about why they still believe in God, then you get a different answer altogether. And when you look at both the answers, you will recognize that they clash. The answers clash, but they're not equal. Because if you weigh out the evidence, you will find that one argument is an emotional argument, and the other is an argument that is based on not just experience, but on deep logic, logic of experience and real life. And when you put those two together, for me, who am looking on in an intellectual manner, the weight of evidence clearly shifts to the side of there is a God. I have asked this question to them. Let's throw off God. How much better does the world become? Can you guarantee me a world that is better than this if you throw off God? We can look at some places. A real life example would be atheistic countries, communist countries that by their constitution throw off God. Let's look at those countries. Let's go to Russia. Let's go to North Korea and ask if they have individual rights. Do they have justice? Do they have a commonality of spirit by which you support one another to lift each one up? And you will find that in them, you will not find anything that is called equality.
How?
There is only a suppression and an oppression.
I hear you. Can I take it a little bit deeper?
Sure.
How would you, as a philosopher, Bible scholar, student, teacher, professor, how would you relate to a parent then? Let's go to the parents who have a child in hospital who has bone cancer. Let's make it even more appalling. Brain cancer. I have a friend actually right now who has a child who has brain cancer. Interestingly, they, like you said, they're holding their faith strong and God is sustaining them through this. But if I have a child that has brain cancer, 12 months old, one that I've longed for, God's blessed us with this baby. Now it's got brain cancer and it's dying, and I come to you and I say, where is God? I've prayed to him. I can't hear him. He seems a million miles away if he exists at all. Where is God? Because in my 30 years of of ministry, I have seen this question drive people two ways, closer to God or far, far away. What would you say as a philosopher teacher? What would your answer be to someone who came to you and asked that question? A question I think Stephen Fry is reflecting in his own belligerent way.
That is true. In fact, this is a question that is so common that if a Christian is unable to answer that, I believe he needs to go a little deeper and find out what he really believes. So your question to me as a philosopher, as a student of the Bible, as maybe a person who will deal with intellectual, the first thing I will do is put aside my intellectualism. I will stop immediately there. I will put my arm around the person and weep with them. Do not try an intellectual answer at that point. There is a time for that. Ecclesiastes 3 says there's a time for everything. This is not the time to give a profound philosophical answer to that. Not at that moment. So my first response, I will weep with them because I feel the hurt and the pain that a parent would have. And when I have finished with that, if they ask me for an intellectual answer, then only will I give an intellectual answer. Only then will I do a philosophical discussion. Otherwise, no, sir. I will hold their hands, wrap my hands around their shoulders, and weep with them.
So you're saying when people ask that sort of question, they're more or less in a frame where they need ministry and support rather than discussions on at that level?
They need empathy more than anything else. And if you want to show your God, then please at that moment exhibit the empathy that God has. Do not give an intellectual answer.
And if it was 3 years down the track and the child had died and they were still asking that question, then you'd take us where you've already taken us in the discussion before and look at the evidences of God. Am I correct?
We could do that. And at the same time, the question has not been answered.
Okay.
The question is, how can a loving, almighty God allow pain and suffering? That question still remains. Mm. So just because we are empathetic does not mean we have answered the question. Mm. We have to recognize that the question has not been answered. So when we look at that, the attempt then to make an answer would require us to pull back some amount and look at it in an intellectual way. And here is how I would at least start the addressing. Number one, we have agreed that the discrepancy and the contradiction arises because of supernatural characteristics. He is all loving, we are not. He is all powerful, we are not. So we are dealing now with a commodity, an entity that is not natural, that is supernatural. So there's one more attribute we should add to this and then start. Number one is we said he is almighty, so he can do anything. He is all loving. So if he's almighty and all loving, he should do only loving things. That's the argument. But when we look at it, we should look at it now from the point of view of the supernatural angle. And there we find not only almightiness, omnipotence, not only omniscience, but one more thing, he is all wise. That is what most people forget. See, if I go to a specialist, a top specialist, and he says, you got to take this medicine, but this medicine will cause you headache. It'll cause you feeling really horrible for those days when you take the medicine. But in the end, it'll save your life. Then because of the wisdom of that specialist, I will take it no matter how bitter it is. We often look at ourselves and say, isn't it bad and horrible to chop off somebody's limb? And we say, that's a horrible thing to do. But if the person who is doing it is a very top oncology surgeon who is amputating your limb because that is the only way your life would be saved, then that horrible action is no longer horrible. So when we look at it from God's point of view, now there are some things that really come out to us. Number one, He is all wise. So if He is all wise, He does not have to give us all the answers right away. In His wisdom, He knows that if He starts discussing out with it with us, we will get so totally confused, we will not be able to accept the concepts that He has from His point of view. Number one. Number two, He has told us, if He's in existence, He's real, then He has told us that this is only temporary.
Yeah. That's a big point.
In other words, yeah, this is your bitterness of the medicine you are taking. But remember, the bitter medicine ultimately leads you to a better existence after that. Number two. Now, that's number two. Number three is...
In other words, everything is followed by eternity.
In other words, we are looking at it from a supernatural point of view, and there you have to accept that our perspective is not the 1900 years that we live on this earth, but it is in the terms of eternity.
Okay.
Now, what happens if you look at it in terms of the magnitude of your suffering? A person can suffer for 60, 70, 80 years. But what if God says, for any amount of suffering, anyone who has suffered, I will pay you back. I will pay you a billion times back.
Yeah.
Not to worry, I will do it. And so when I look on the world and the people who suffer, honestly, I'm not suffering like many of them. And they do suffer. But when I look at them, I tell myself in my own mind, these people are going to get it even more than me when that day of reckoning comes. I will get my certain amount if I keep close to my God. But these people who suffer, God has said He will make it up to them. Not a single bit of suffering will ever be left out of the equation. He'll do it because He told us He is a God of truth. So if we trust Him, then the answers come from His angle, the answer and perspective of eternity, which more than settles what we are trying to do with our little lives here.
Okay, I think that's a beautiful thought, isn't it? When you're going through suffering, that God has something in store for us which is much better in the future. And I have seen that sustain people, that thought that I will be with God soon. I will be with Him for eternity. I've seen that sustain people right through, which is a wonderful thing, isn't it?
Absolutely. It's not just the quantity. In other words, it's not just 90 years versus a billion years. That's the quantity. But what the quality of life?
Yeah.
One day in that life will wipe off all the troubles that we've had for our entire lives.
Oh, how
so
long.
If we are looking, yes, we have to long for that. And that is why a true believer longs for that time when everything will be settled here and we can go home. We call it Beulah Land.
Yeah.
And that's where we're about.
It's trust in God through the darkness of this world. It really is. Can I change direction now?
Sure.
Because there are some areas I want to go into. Evolution. If I'm a student at university or I'm a teacher, a professor in the area of the sciences, and I'm studying evolution, is there room in the Christian experience, in the Christian paradigm, for theistic evolution? And what I mean by that is God puts the process in place. Evolution is how the world came into being, and at times God would insert Himself to provide the supernatural. In other words, it was God who took the inorganic to organic. Do you know what I mean? So he'll help those little jumps. You know what theistic evolution is. My question is simple. Can you be a Christian and believe in theistic evolution? Because a lot of young people who are in university or even some of our colleges are coming back to me and they're saying, this is how I see it. So I still believe in God. I still believe in Jesus the Savior, but I believe in theistic evolution. And the book of Genesis, well, it's good, but it's probably just a poem.
Well, you've asked more than one question in that then, because you went to the book of Genesis. So let's stick to the point that you first asked. Can a Christian believe in theistic evolution? The short answer is actually no. But the discussion answer will say, if you really want to believe in evolution, then you cannot be a theist. You will be a deist. A deist is one who believes that God started it off and, you know, cranked it up and then went for a walk and let the uncranking take place, and that's how evolution took place. Well, a deist is not really a Christian, because a Christian has to be a theist who recognizes that God didn't just turn the key and walk off. He has been there right from the beginning and has been all along. Now, that is the way a Christian would look at it. But look at it from the point of view of the actual theory of evolution. The basics of the theory of evolution is based on what is called natural selection. What does that word natural mean? It means everything that is within the natural realm. It means that there was nothing other than the natural. Only natural laws of science took place. So if you are going to bring God, it will be an oxymoron. It will be like saying supernatural natural selection. That is impossible. So we just get into a real clash right there. You can't have a supernatural natural selection. It's either supernatural selection or natural selection. They are mutually exclusive. You cannot have both. The other thing to look at when you look at theistic evolution is to ask yourself, well, the first book of the Bible, Genesis, and especially the first chapter, and they say that we can throw off. Why would you throw it off? Because it's not scientific. Really? It's not scientific? Let's start with the first four words. In the beginning, God. When you look at the words in the beginning, let's recognize now something right here. That science has been in vogue now for a long time. And these words were written about 3,000 years ago. When did science finally agree that the universe had a beginning? When we look at history of science, the time when they really finally agreed was in the 1970s. Before that, they could not dare say that the universe had a beginning, because if they said so, then the next question would be, well, if there's a beginning, there has to be a beginner. And they didn't want that. So they would shy away from even stating that there was a beginning. Then came the theory, the Einstein's theory of relativity, and all the field equations of gravity. And when they extrapolated that along with what is called the red shift in looking at the galaxies that are moving away and extrapolating them backwards, we had to come to a single point, and we could not escape the point. So mathematically, they were forced to say, this universe had a beginning point. When? In the 1970s, science required 3,000 years to just catch up with the first four words of Genesis 1, verse 1. The first three words are in the beginning. The next word is God. You see, when you look at anything that begins, so first of all, the word is Genesis. So we are on the same wavelength. It's Genesis. Secondly, when you start off something, you have to recognize that whatever starts off is the final source. The ultimate source of everything has to come from that one point. So if you look at the point and you say it was absolute nothingness, how can everything come from nothing? So that knocks off that one option. The two options are the agent or nothing. Nothing cannot produce everything. You ask the agent. Now you look at the agency and look at what we have today in the world. For example, we do have matter and energy. Where did that come from? It had to come from the source. Now look at the source. Let's look at energy, for example. If you take, you know, in the United States, we have pennies, the smallest little coin, about 2 to 3 grams. You know what? How much energy that is there in that one penny?
A fair bit.
I'll tell you the equation.
Yep.
If you converted one penny, just one penny, into energy, it would give you the amount of energy that was in the atomic, no, three times the amount of energy that was in the atomic bomb that was blasted over Hiroshima. Mm. So with that amount of energy from one penny, can you imagine how much energy there is in just the building where we are sitting?
Yeah.
What about the world? What about the solar system, where we have only one star? And the star is 96% of the mass of the solar system. And it's only one star. We have 200 billion stars in our Milky Way galaxy. We have 600 billion galaxies. Can you imagine the source having that amount of power to give that amount of energy so that it could form all these galaxies? That is why Aristotle, way back in 300 BC, when he looked at the logic of it, he said that if there is an explanation of the world, that explanation would have to be omnipotent and omniscient.
Yeah.
So when we come to those points, we recognize that we cannot escape from the idea that theistic evolution cannot really work unless this source does the whole thing all along, so that it is not a natural selection, but it becomes automatically a supernatural selection by which he does things. However, there's one point in which we agree with the theory of evolution, and that is the fact that there is changes. There are changes in variations, and those changes are acceptable because there is something known as kind in the Bible, in the first chapter. It's not called species, kind. So in the kind, you can change. Mm. So when you look at the two theories, the theory of evolution, the theory of creation, it appears that the theory of creation has the better set of basic evidence for it than the theory of evolution. So I would say on balance, we can't go to theistic evolution, because that is not, you can go to deistic evolution, not theistic evolution. And if you go to theos, then that God exists all the time and is absolutely, deeply, completely interested in everything that happens on the earth. So he's not sleeping.
Yeah. I wish we had more time to go deeper into that, because we can get into the fact that if creation didn't occur as God says in the Bible, then you've got problems with the fall of man, and you've got problems with the promise of the cross, and theistic evolution in a sense destroys the cross and the reason for Jesus to come. But I want to ask you some other questions in other areas, because we've only got you for a limited time. 6,000 years, young earth, old earth, does it matter for the Christian?
Not if you are aiming only to live on this earth, then those things don't matter at all. But if you are aiming to come to a position in which your faith and your trust is based on something that is broad and sturdy, then you have to agree that certain concepts which are claimed as basic concepts must be established. You cannot have a non-established base and still be sturdy. So if this base says that it is the young earth, then there should be some evidence in the world in which we live that the world is young. and the solar system is young.
So you're saying that just before you go any further, you're saying a base. Are you saying the Bible's, in your view, teaches a young earth? Is that what you're saying? Is that the base you're talking about? Or sorry if I've got that wrong.
The base I'm talking about is the claim that is set on evidence. So the claim must be settled first. The claim is that when you look at the genealogy in the Bible and count the number of years, then it does come to a very young earth.
Thank you.
So we can't escape that.
That's all I wanted to establish. So, okay, go on.
Once you establish that, now the question is it really correct that the Bible is telling the truth, or is it really goes into the millions and billions of years? The universe, according to them, is 13.72 billion years old, and the world itself is 4.53 billion years. So is that correct, or is just less than 10,000 years correct? So that now requires a study. Requires again an honest looking into the facts and into the scientific evidence we have today. So when we look at those, here's how I would do it and how I did it. Draw a line, and one end is zero and the other is 4.5 billion years, and they divide that line into three portions. You can put it wherever you want to, the points. The first portion, if the scientific evidence falls into the first portion, then it will point towards 10,000 years as the age of the earth. If it falls into the third portion, then it'll point to the 4.5 billion years. If it falls into the middle third, or not third, middle section, then it'll be inconclusive. So we have three. Now what we should do is look around for scientific evidences and put them wherever they fall. When you do that, and we don't have time, we could do that. But when you do that, here's what you will find. You will find some very powerful evidences that this atmosphere of ours around the earth is very young. The rocks that are actually deep down there, which they have done studies, is actually very young. In fact, the cosmos, which has the galaxies around us, is actually young. In other words, what I'm saying is there are evidences in scientific terms that it is young. But there are also questions about how being it being old. And those, the two that are point to the old ones, is called radiometric dating, the dating of the rocks. And the second one is the speed of light and the distance that light travels. So those two do point to a long age. So we got to look at both of those things. And if we had time, we could. And when you look at them, the weight of evidence still falls on the side of a young earth less than 10,000 years. So I have not mentioned what the points are, but if you want, I could mention one or two.
Well, maybe what we should do is get you back next year to do a series on all these different questions we've been asking you. But yes, let's hear one or two on why you think it's a young Earth.
Let's do just one.
Yep.
Let's do one Earth and one Moon. Yep. The Earth. Carbon. When you do carbon dating, you recognize that Carbon-14 is formed in the upper atmosphere of the Earth, and carbon-14 is the radioactive carbon. And carbon-14 then comes into the world and into our lives and then decays. The rate of decay is trying to catch up with the rate of actual formation, all right?
Yep.
So Willard Libby, who got the Nobel Prize for carbon dating, when he did his calculations, he said if we start from scratch, then they would reach equilibrium within 20 to 30,000 years. It has not reached equilibrium yet. So the atmosphere that we are looking around and surrounding us is less than 20,000 years old.
Yep.
And when you look at the rate at which it is moving, then it becomes comes closer to 10,000 years.
Okay.
So one more. The way in which radioactive material comes out of rocks is from uranium-238, and when uranium finally forms lead, which is non-radioactive, it gives off radiation. And that radiation grabs some hydrogen ions and becomes helium. Helium is very small, very tiny, so it escapes from the rocks. So if that helium has been there a long time, and we are looking for helium, after a certain period of time, you should find no helium because helium has escaped. So when you look at the rate at which it escapes and the rate at which it reduces, you can check what rate would be relating to what age. In other words, if it is a very slow rate, we could postulate, let's say, 4.5 billion years. But if it is a very rapid rate, then the time period is very short. So here's what they have done, and this is a real study. They have looked at samples way down in the earth and pulled out those what's called zircon crystals in which they find these helium atoms and the lead atoms, and they have checked it over a period of years. Now, if they checked it over a period of years, they can possibly calculate the rate. Guess where the rate falls? The rate falls at less than 10,000 years.
Yep.
So when we look at actual data, it does point to a young Earth. But we have now to go to the other side and explain, what do we mean by radioactive and why are they showing 4.5 billion years? And what about this light travel of galaxies more than 12 billion light years away? We need to discuss that maybe another time.
Yeah, that's a question I have in my mind too. What about light that's come to us from a long way away? In my head, I'm just thinking, oh, well, God created a mature Earth. But let's go back to that because I've got some other questions. He's shaking his head, Pastor, you're off with the fairies. I'm sure I am. I want to ask this because we've got 10 minutes, 11 minutes to go. I listen to you. Sometimes you almost are above my head with your, because you are so educated, you are so deep into this. You've spent so many years looking at these questions. Sometimes I think us pastors are kind of just on the edge of it, if you know what I mean. But my question is this: why is it, and it's where we ended last week, and perhaps you can give us an insight into this. Why is it that so many of our Christian, and it's not a condemning question, it's a question to help us understand. Why is it that you've come to the conclusions you have come to, and to me as I'm listening and I'm trying to keep up, they all seem fair enough, but why are so many of our professors and our teachers and even our university students, why aren't they coming to the same conclusions you are? And what as a church can we do to stop them drifting that way instead of this way with Christ? So it's a two-part question. Why are they going in that direction when you obviously haven't? You haven't. Okay, and the second one is, what can we do?
Let's answer one at a time, and then you can ask me the second one. Okay, the first one is, why are they doing that? You see, every professor who stands in front of a class wants to be seen as a credible individual. No professor wants to stand and be taunted and mocked. So the way a professor, especially a science professor, whether in a believing college or whether in a secular college, they want to be seen as science-based. So when they look at that, the wave and the strength of the arguments coming from science appear to show that evolution is correct. That is why they feel that the theory of evolution has a scientific base. That is why they say, well, all right, let's teach it. Let's go ahead with it. Here's the reason why they and I are different. Because when I looked at it, I didn't just swallow what they said. I said, let's look at some of the things that they are really saying. Let's look at some of the actual claims that they are making and pit those claims against the evidence we have. And there are very few, even of the evolutionistic world, who have ever done this. They do not care to do this because it is too well accepted. There is no need to go there. And so even in our own circles, we will find people and professors who go that way. They do not want to be seen as, you know, people who are just without any credibility. So they follow that. I believe that that is time now to stand up and do what is called critical thinking. Not peer pressure, not comfort zones, because that is what is needed right now. So why do they go there? They fully believe it is scientific.
Do you see more and more critical thinking coming in, especially amongst our own men and women who lecture, teach, and who are our professors?
No, sadly not. In fact, the statistics in the United States is that 45% to 55% of our youth who go to secular universities never come back to the church. The tsunami, the tidal wave of atheism and evolution is simply too much. We cannot expect them to stand, especially when we have not given them a shield or an armor. If we just say that here's the Bible, go and do it. Look, the Bible is not the reference of on a public campus. That is not a reference point that we can say tells us what the truth of the matter is. We have to speak their language, and that is where critical thinking comes in. There is very little critical thinking today, and we need to get to that. We need to come to a point where we weigh things out.
How do we get the professors in our Adventist colleges then, and the teachers in our schools, our high schools, and our primary schools to a place where we can, even before they get to university, how can we get our children into a place so that they're ready to face this? Because as you said, it's a tsunami and we're losing them.
It is a huge tsunami. And if we are losing them, then somebody should stand up and speak it out. I'm willing to do that. I'm willing to do it to the extent possible, because I can see the difference. I can see that there's a reason why they are going that way. And I can see also that we can challenge that reason by good scientific, intellectual, logical arguments that will settle the base and settle the question. And when we do that, I have seen people turn right around in 1 hour. These are hard-nosed atheists from top-notch, institutes of the world. And I've been to some top-notch ones. MIT, Harvard, Duke, Georgia Tech. I have seen hard-nosed atheists immediately, in 1 hour, turn around and say, boy, if that's the information that is supposed to be there, count me a believer from today.
What's stopping that information getting out in our own church, in our own colleges, in our own schools?
There are simply too few of us who have this information. We are focused, our theology is focused only or basically in trying to differentiate our church from the other Christian churches, especially from the Roman Catholics. We do not have a theology that aims to answer these questions. We are tied up with that. That is not bad. We need this as well. And so we should do both. This is the deficiency. That is why it's a passion with me. I would like to just go out. In fact, there was a person in one of the conferences who heard me and said, I wish I could fill up a stadium with 10,000 people and have you speak to them. Well, that is the idea. We need to get this out to as many people as possible, that there is a foundational set of arguments that will settle these questions. Like finally a medical student in Africa told me, you have settled me for life. That is the way we should do it. And I believe when you do that, they will be settled for life.
It almost seems like we're sending our kids off to university unprepared, unknown, almost like babes to the slaughter. Because we ourselves are struggling with these issues, or else these issues are not relevant to us, one or the other.
Right. And most likely it is the former. We are not prepared ourselves. You know, I've seen so many of them saying, can I ask you a question? I'm playing the devil's advocate. But I tell them, you're not playing the devil's advocate. You're actually asking the question yourself, because you didn't answer that. That's why you're asking me, because you didn't have the answer. So first, let's confess we don't have the answer. The answer comes in information. The information bank on this side of the reservoir is very, very little. It is like we are starving for that. We need to get the information out, and I will do all that I can possibly do to do that.
Do you see hope for the future? In that, okay, you're one man, and I know a couple of others in our church who stand, but there's not many, because we don't have the, as you said, we're not educated to answer these questions successfully. Do you see hope for the future, or are you pessimistic? Perhaps that's not a good way to bring this end, but...
No, there is hope. Here's what I'd say. If you have honestly looked at these questions, then like me, you will come to a very sturdy conclusion that there is God. Hmm. Whose job is it to bring all the people into the fold?
All of us.
It is God's job.
Yeah, true.
It is God's job.
Yeah.
It is God's job. And here's what I say. Here's why I say there is hope, and there's huge amounts of hope. One person and God make a majority. Isn't that what we've heard many times before? I and God are a majority. So if I'm on God's side, then we are on the majority. He has given us certain promises. And if we trust him, then he's going to keep the promise. In fact, there's a statement made, and some of you, us who are Adventists, we will know it, called it Steps to Christ, where it says, if you believe the promise, God supplies the fact. We are not supposed to bring the fact about. Yeah. We do the believing and agree with Hebrews 11:1, which says faith is the substance of things hoped for. Yeah. What are you hoping for? Are you hoping for a big revival? Bring faith. Are you hoping for energy? Bring faith, which is the substance. Are you hoping for a lot of wisdom? Bring faith, which is the substance. And when you bring the faith, which is the substance, which a promise, with a promise to God, he supplies the fact. He is going to see us through. There's no question about that.
Well, thank you. I wish we had more time, but we're out of time. I would like to say this. When COVID-19 is over, we would love you to come out to Australia to New Hope. Amen, church? That way we could not have to worry about the Zoom. Probably wouldn't have to worry about this pastor interfering with silly questions. We could just put you up the front and let you go. But I would love that. But even if we are stuck in our countries, you know, for the next 12, 18 months, let's get together. We've got Pastor Wayne here. He'll help us. And let's put a series together sometime next year where we'll get you back here at New Hope, whether it's on Zoom or live, and let's discover and investigate and go further down this road, these very interesting areas. So thank you.
I am very privileged, and thank you that you have invited me over, and definitely we will do more.
Okay, thank you very much. It's helped my faith, and I know it's helped a lot of us here too. So God bless you. Let me close with a prayer. Again, God bless you. Thank you very much, Dr. Pandit. We hope to see you again soon. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for this stimulating, very wise man who challenges us with the truth and brings us assurance, not just of your existence, but of your place and your purpose in our universe. And I just pray that you'll bless Dr. Pandit and his ministry, that you'll widen it, that more people will hear this message, be drawn to you, want to know you and believe in you through faith. Thank you that you are a real God and that you offer yourself to us today. In Jesus' name, Amen.
Amen.
God bless you, Doctor.
God bless everyone.
Okay, thank you very much. That was very interesting. By the way, this is Dr. Pandit's book. One of them, Come Search With Me, Let's Look For God. If you're interested in purchasing... Oh, he's got his hand up, yes?
The book is now in a set of two books.
Yes.
Come Search With Me. It's on Amazon. The first one is entitled, Does God Really Exist? And the second one is The Weight of Evidence. That is what came out of this one. This one, what you have in your hand, is the first edition.
Yep.
The latest is the fourth edition. It has all the stuff in it. And then the one that I just showed you, that is also on Amazon.
Are they all on
Amazon? Setting the record straight.
Are they all on Amazon?
Or all on
Okay,
they're all on Amazon.
Thank you. Well, I got this one from Wayne, and I'm not giving
and
it back.
And also one place. You can ask the Wantok Church. The Wantok Church has hundreds of copies.
Pastor Wayne mentioned that. So if you want one, come and see either Pastor Wayne or myself, and we'll arrange that. Thank you, Doctor. God bless you guys. We'll see you back here in 10 minutes for church.